He's an old head.
Youngins are really starting to get on my damn nerves.
He's a purveyor of nonsense. He's a Georgia high school coaching job influencer. His favorite Bible verse is Jesus wept. He's the man of constant sorrow, Chris Lamb.
Sun Coaches is proud to partner with Titan Sports for the next four seasons on Sun Coaches Podcast. Titan GPS delivers technological superiority and improved player performance through wearable GPS made for high school football and strength and conditioning. From speed training to athlete recruit to workload enhancement, Titan is the easy-to-use yet comprehensive GPS tool to get it done. There's no minimum to get started, and Titan will walk you through every step to success. Message us on X at Titan Sensor to learn more and get in touch. Welcome to Season 4 of Sun Coaches Podcast, and today I'm joined by a guy that has retired from the state of Georgia. He's currently coaching in Alabama. He's been a head coach in both states, done it a long time. He's an old head, Coach Ken Cofer. Thanks for being on with us, Coach.
Appreciate you having me on, man. I've heard a lot about it.
Well, Coach, where did you grow up and play your high school ball at?
Grew up in Dallas, Georgia, Paulding County High School, and that was the only high school back then. There's probably five now, probably possible six incoming, so not really home anymore, but that used to be the place. And, you know, my dad used to be the head football coach back there in the early 70s, and we moved around quite a lot. I ended up there from the third grade on, and glad I did. Thought about playing for my dad at Sprayberry High School when he was there, but glad I stayed with my buddies that I grew up with and played rec ball with. So it was a good time. We still have a group text now that we talk at least every week, shoot the crap, tell lies, all that kind of stuff.
So you're a coach's kid that didn't play for his dad.
Yeah, I actually played against my dad. You know, my dad met my mama at Manchester High School way back in the day. She's a Manchester girl, and he was coaching there. And I was named after one of my dad's players, Ken Phillips, and that played at Manchester, then on to Southern Miss, and played for the guy I was named after. So Ken Phillips, I played for him. He was Big Ken. I was Little Ken. But my dad was a head football coach at Paulding County, spent until he died in 96, spent all his time coaching in Georgia. My mom is 80 years old, and she is a retired educator from public school, but she teaches at a private school right outside of Manchester right now, called Flint River Academy. And she is there. And in teaching, she can't stand to not do anything. So yeah, I'm the son of two educators, actually.
So you didn't pass the test. You didn't check the right box when you went off to school.
Well, my dad told me a long time ago, Ken, you're an idiot if you get into coaching. Boy, they ain't no money in this. And I said, Pop, I just wanna be happy, because I saw my dad with a big old plug at the back of in his mouth and enjoying it, you know, just having that relationship with kids and other coaches. And I thought, that's happiness. That's fun. That's what I want to do. So I've been around that my whole life and known what I wanted to do since I was 4 years old, being that little water boy, towel guy, fall boy, all that kind of junk. So I did it all.
Yeah, my daddy was a paper maker, and when I came home and told him I was going to teach and coach, it about broke his heart. And he was like, well, I hope you like eating hamburger. I like eating steak. And I said, well, Daddy, I've watched you come off that paper mill, out of that paper yes. mill, my whole life, miserable.
Yeah.
And when I get miserable, I'll do something else.
Amen. I'd rather, the school day, every day is different. I mean, yeah, you're going to have some fights and all that kind of stuff, but man, it's different every day. My day is never the same, and I mean that in a good way.
And they're just
kids.
Yeah,
there's good days and bad. Yeah, there's kids, and look, we all work for four good people, four bad people in the past, and definitely with some bad people and with some good people, but it's not any different than any other job, man, but It's a good time. I enjoy going to work every day.
Where did you go to college? Are you a West Georgia guy or did you go?
I am a West Georgia guy. I graduated with a history degree and a geography minor. And I tell people that because I brag, but I didn't mean to do that on purpose because my grades sucked so bad that I just had to keep taking classes to get my GPA up. And I went to Jacksonville State, very proud Jacksonville State alum, got my social studies certification over there, and did my student teaching in Heflin, Alabama at Cleburne County High School. And that's actually, I live probably half a mile from Cleburne County High School right now. My wife is a Heflin girl.
Full circle.
Yeah, full circle, man.
So what was your first job out of college?
Okay, so 96, I graduated from Jacksonville State, and I took a job at Dooley County High School.
Ooh-wee.
And people are going to say, what the piss were you thinking? Well, Joe Salas had just probably gotten, and a lot of people know that name, got that job maybe a year or two before they offered me that job, coaching defensive line and stuff like that. And I didn't have a clue, was young and not very bright and didn't know, I'd been around football my whole life in the coaching part, and I studied and I still do. But it was still young and very green, and my dad died the same week.
Mm.
So I had to back out of that job with Coach Salas and take a job at Harrelson County High School because my dad's old principal at Paulding County, Mr. Dave Harden, who the stadium at Paulding County is named after, was the AD still. He was an older gentleman, but he told my mother, I'd take care of Ken up here, and I had to take care of a lot of money situations after my dad died. So spent 6 years at Harrelson County, and then went on to Manchester High School. Wanted to be a coordinator and work for the legend Zeke Deer at Manchester High School. And a lot of people, when they hear this, will know that name. And I got to coach with that dude in the silver shoes. And I always wanted to say that I got to coach with a man with the silver shoes in a game, in our last game against Greenville, he did it. So, but I learned a lot at Harrelson County, not the best program in the world overall. Worked with a guy who's my mentor, Brian Warren. And Brian is the AD at Harrelson County High School, and pretty much both of them right now at the middle school too. And he is Mr. Harrelson County, as I call him. And he taught me a lot about, not just coaching ball, but what comes with it. You got to build stuff. And we used to have to do that back then and do a lot of work that I didn't even know came with coaching. So you learn a whole lot when you first start. And some of these, you said old head. Man, I'm proud of that. I sure am proud of being one of the old head guys and all this, because some of these young guys now don't have a clue about what it is to work and build things that you never knew you'd have to do when you start coming up coaching.
Pull a string.
Man, pull the freaking string. And I'm so dang tired of bending over painting numbers and pulling the freaking string and all that kind of crap. And when I came to Heflin, of all places, they were getting a turf field. So for 2 years, I got to be on a turf field and kind of forgot what it was like to paint a field until I came to Weaver High School.
Coach, you'd lost your mind. We got one of those. We got in with the baseball group too, and softball, I think, and paid to have that little machine that does it.
Yes.
I sat out there and watched that and I was just amazed.
Yes.
I was like, this is the greatest thing I've ever seen in my life. And I'm asking the guy all these questions. He's just laughing at me. I said, you mean to tell me that you can just type this in and it'll paint it? And he goes, yeah, in about 3 hours. I said, you just stand here. And he goes, yeah. I said, what if it's wrong? He goes, it ain't wrong. Like, this is fantastic.
Hey, I forgot what it's called. Turf tank.
Yeah, that's it.
We just gave them a plug. So
yes, turf tank. Go get one. It's worth it.
I think we might just do that simply because you just said you went in with, all the fields. So softball coach coaches football too. So does the baseball coach. So we may just go in that together, and that might be a good way to do things.
But yeah, if you got a grass field, God almighty knows, yes, it is worth every penny.
Well, at the beginning, I thought it just painted the lines and the hashes and the ticks and all that kind of stuff. But now it paints your design too with color and everything, doesn't it?
Oh yeah, it'll do your logo. It'll do all your numbers, your logo. It'll put whatever you want in the end zone. I mean,
man, I'm so far behind the times, but see, you just made a plug for Turf Tank for us. So
it's unreal. It's what I told him. I said, y'all can take however much out of my supplement you need to.
Yeah,
it's worth it.
Yes.
You know, because once you get to be a certain age, the money don't matter no more.
Yeah.
I don't care. I'm like, you mean I don't have to stay up here on a Wednesday or Thursday night and do this, pull a string?
That's right. Man, I'm telling you, we'll do it, definitely. I got a good old PE teacher named Chris Trott that goes out there and takes kids out there and paints it. You know, I had to repaint the lines and stuff, but I think Turf Tank is in our future.
Oh, yeah.
So we said Turf Tank about five times on here, so they ought to give us a little money for saying their name.
Well, we've been in, we were in Manchester. They were in our region last 2 years at Taylor County, and there's nothing better than going over there and seeing the stoplight in the end zone.
There you go. There you go. Not a lot of people know about that, but, you know, I remember seeing it back in the day when Zeke said that, and Coach New now was on the other side of that. He was the head coach at Irwin. So I got to Coach New is one of my mentors too. And I never remembered that that was Coach New that Zeke was talking about. And that was the red light stuff. So, you know, still talk to Coach New every now and then. And he's still down there in South Georgia. And I'm going to tell you, man, I grew up in North Georgia and I'm in North Alabama, right above, probably 5 minutes above, I-20, and I miss the leaves, I miss the mountains and all that kind of stuff, but I sure do miss South Georgia too.
Yeah. And, I tell the young coaches, they're like, what's that red light there for? I said, well, on GPTV one time in front of God and everybody, Zeke said, turn right at the red light and get ready to get the hell knocked out of
there. That's exactly right.
And he wasn't lying.
He wasn't lying. And
it ain't bragging if you can do it.
Yep. And he still speaks that way. And I still hear, you know, Zeke tells my kin folks certain things that I can't repeat on here to tell me. And I'll tell you about Zeke Gear, is he was a tremendous influence on me. I'm going to say, that ain't good. But now football wise, seriously, you know, that dude was very aggressive, and he was, I wouldn't say set in his way. He was just going, you know, be aggressive. And that's why they got those defenses to play so hard when he was there. And,
Jap-stack.
I appreciated that. Yes, absolutely. And, you know, hey, at the coaching clinics, anybody will tell you, I'm sure you can too, that sometimes it ain't the clinic that you learn the most from. It's the hotel rooms, and you get in there talking to other coaches and you learn a lot. And Zeke, it came out of his mouth that he learned that Jap defense, you know, in a hotel room, just sitting there having a few cold ones right there and talking football. And that's just the truth, you know, and people teach you things and you learn something every time.
So where'd you end up going after Manchester?
Yeah, well, here's the thing, is right before I went to Manchester, I got married. And just like a lot of, I don't want to say most, but just like a lot of high school football coaches, I probably married the wrong woman because she was not a coach's wife whatsoever. But I married her right before we went to Manchester, and we moved three times in 3 years, and it wore me out. She wasn't happy with any of those. And she ended up staying down there in Lanier County. She still lives down there in Lakeland, Georgia. And I moved back to North Georgia and went to, after Manchester, went to Lakeland for a year. Some of the discipline issues there kind of got to me a little bit. Came back with all the old Harrelson County guys and went to Villarica for a year. We almost got a divorce, the wife and I, at that time. And came back down to Lanier and coached at Cook and was there for 9 years. And had some dang good teams at Cook High School. And probably, I've been to a lot of good places, but Cook High School was probably the one I felt the most at home. But you know as well as I do, you know, things, especially during this time and day and age, is they don't last. When you get new board members or you get a new superintendent or you get a new principal and things change, and it can change your love. Now, I still talk to all the Cook boys down there. I miss Adel, Georgia so bad, I can't stand it. But I don't miss some of the so-called leadership that came in right there in my last years there.
Yeah, I remember playing y'all. I was with Michael Pollock at Americas, and I was at D.C. when we played y'all, and we were in the same region, I think.
Yes,
and,
yes.
Then I left there and went to Early, and somehow we still ended up in the Cook region.
Yes.
Like, I can't get away from these people.
Had some wars with Early County. I'm going to tell you a secret, and I told another coach this one time, and, you know, people might say, I saw a lot of similarities with Early and Cook, and just athlete-wise right there. And I said, you know what, if I couldn't be at Cook High School, man, I tell you what, that Early County job would be something I would love to have, you know. And I know they kind of went up and down too, but I just remember Early County from back in the day when I started at Cook, and we had some wars at Early County now.
So where did you go after Cook?
So I resigned at Cook after 9 years and took the Bacon County job. Bacon County is where, shoot, man, if you Google me, and I tell kids this all the time, I'm pretty transparent. You'll find some good things about me and you'll find some bad things. And I say somewhere in the middle is the truth. And Bacon County days were good. They took care of me. There's a lot of good people there, a lot of kids there. And I'm going to be honest right here that, and I know some people don't like people being too honest, but I'm going to be honest. As I got out of my mind a little bit there my second year, I think when you have success, Chris, is that head starts to blow up a little bit and you start believing that it's about you. And that happened a little bit at Cook, and I took a little swagger with me to Bacon. And it got a little out of hand the second year. But look, man, some idiot at Bacon that was part of my release made up a story that I grabbed a kid in the weight room. Never happened. I was as close to that kid as I've ever been to a kid in my life. Played football there. Loved him to death. We were very close and made up that. Now, there were words exchanged. I'd had a bad night the night before with some family, the ex-wife and my oldest daughter that I had to go handle. And O'Shawn had some issues with his family the night before. And there were some words exchanged. But this goes to show you that a lot of people, and it took me, 2 years to get another head coaching job. And Wilcox County took a chance on me. I went to Dodge after Bacon County. And I got pretty much fired and my contract bought out at Bacon. I still love that place. I still love a lot of those people. There's a couple right there that are not on my good list. But some I deserved and some didn't. But I didn't really deserve to have a bunch of crap that wasn't true put on the freaking, the sports vent. And then people just ran off with it and just assumed it was true. And the guys put that on there just to make themselves feel better, have a little backing about why they got rid of me, which was 100% false. And that crap's still on Google. You can Google it up today. It's still on there. It still breaks my heart because but there's nothing I can do about it. But you get in this business and, you know, people are going to say good things about you and bad, and there's nothing you can do. You know, people are going to make their assumptions and stuff like that. So for about 2 years, Rex Hodges, I got nothing but good things to say about Rex Hodges at Dodge County. He did a lot of calling on me, and they had no backing on anything that I had done wrong. He took a chance, and, man, I coached linebackers for 2 years for Rex at Dodge. And I probably got 11 or 12 interviews for head jobs the last 2 years. And I think they were interviews to just say that they had former head coaches on there that had been decently successful. And hey, they weren't the best person. And I was the guinea pig for those. And I kept asking the good Lord, I said, why, God, am I not getting these? And every one of those programs that I interviewed for, either something bad happened to them, or it just wasn't a good situation that I needed to be in. And I'm going to tell you, man, God has always had me. He's always taken care of me, and I've had to learn some hard lessons. But Wilcox County is a place I wish I never would have left. And a lot of people say, man, there ain't a whole lot in Rochelle, Georgia. I don't give a flip. I'm just telling you, the good freaking people that came out of Rochelle that's still there, right there. And, man, I should have never left. Wilcox County is a gem, and the administration there was great. They're still there. So if anybody's asking about Wilcox County, great place to be, man. It really is. Now, small, it ain't got a whole lot there, but they got some good athletes and some good people there. But lo and behold, Rex Hodges retires, and you're probably going to ask me this question. Rex Hodges retires. 5 minutes after he retires, I get phone calls out to Yin Yang after me being at Wilcox for a year and a half. And I'm going to tell you the statement that was said to me on the phone is, Coach, we need a head football coach. I got a brand new truck for you. You're going to get a raise, and we're going to raise some money. And without asking God for any kind of guidance whatsoever, and my youngest daughter, Kaylee, who's about to graduate from Auburn in December, was sitting there bawling her eyes out because she knew I was fixing to take it. And I took it. So let me get into this, because I know you're going to ask me this too. So, you know, back in the day, you used to chase athletes. We still chase athletes as coaches. But you also chase administration too. And that's what's good about Wilcox County. The superintendent on down at Wilcox, man, is great. Dodge County, administration. Now, I'm not talking about the high school administration that's there now, but what was there and is at the superintendent's office. Now, Chris, I told you before we did this interview right here that I really didn't give a piss what anybody thought or anything like that. And if I was still in the state of Georgia, I can assure you that some of those Dodge County people would laugh and say, yep, Cofer don't give a piss. And I ended up telling them that before I retired. The Wicked Witch of the West that is in the superintendent's office at Dodge County is a mess. And she ain't worth a piss. I'm just going to tell you, she was my principal there. She made my life hell. And it was bad. And now her husband, I ain't got nothing but good things to say about him, but she's got her little cronies right there. And I hope everybody in Dodge hears this, and because over half of them are going to agree with me there. And I hope the Wicked Witch of the West hears this too, but she ain't a whole lot of nothing to me. And that's what's bringing Dodge down a little bit as far as facility wise. And going to that next level, but you still got a bunch of good people in Dodge County. They didn't treat me anything but good at Dodge. But you want to talk about why I retired in Georgia too, and I know you ain't been able to say a word, I'm just flowing with you, man. Is, you know, my baby was graduating from Wilcox. That's my youngest daughter, Kaylee, that's at Auburn now. And my wife was from Heflin. And I wasn't too happy. I love the kids, love the coaches that I coached with at Dodge, love the people I worked with. It was just the leadership there that I was unhappy with and I didn't trust. So I just retired and said, man, I'm just going to go back. I'm going to ride off into the sunset into Alabama. I'm going to retire. And then I'm just going to be a O-line coach or shoot a wide receiver coach or something like that. And that didn't last too long. It lasted about 3 months after I got here that I wanted to be a head coach again. So. But man, hey, I love Alabama. This is a throwback over here now, and you won't know what I'm talking about unless you come over here and coach and go into these rural county high schools. It is a throwback to the way Georgia used to be back in the day. But I sure do miss Georgia too, man. I do. I miss it a lot.
Well, young Josh Cooley, did his student teaching over there, and he loved you, and we've kind of adopted him.
Yeah,
now,
man.
He's in Hawkinsville now, but he thought the world of you. And I played golf with a group, and the orthopedic surgeon over in Eastman, Rosenbaum.
Yes.
Don Rosenbaum, he said, Chris, don't you ever come and tell me that you're coming to coach in Dodge County.
Yes.
He's like, don't do it. He said, don't even be an assistant.
Yeah.
Well, he said, because they're not good to coaches. He said,
no.
The administration's jacked up.
it is. And, you know, I think administration may be better over there at the high school now, And let me tell you that I'm not talking about everybody in Dodge, but the one that's in that superintendent seat right now, I got nothing for her. And she used to be the principal, and she's got her little cronies that do whatever she says to do. And she will not improve a whole lot of nothing. And Rex Hodges is a very special human being, because Rex has got a different kind of patience level than I have. And he just didn't listen to her, and he wouldn't put up with it. And he did his own thing. And Rex was just very quiet. I'm just more vocal. And sometimes that more vocal just gets your tail in some trouble. And it didn't get me in trouble over there, but that lady knew that I did not care for her or anything like that. But man, I got nothing but athlete wise, people wise, they love Dodge County. It is the administration over there. But and I think things have improved since I've left. I really do. I think you got some guys in there that are they've made a lot of money through the Touchdown Club, and it's some good stuff over there now, man. But when you got the Wicked Witch of the West leading the show, still ain't good.
Yeah, it's a problem. I mean, when you go through four head coaches in 5 years, maybe it's you. You know, I mean,
yeah.
some administrators need to take a look back. We can't all be morons.
Yeah, exactly. And she just wants control. She's just one of those. Now listen, and my mama will say this now, and she'll still say this. I just don't want a woman principal or woman superintendent because they get a little power hungry. Well, that's not all of them. I worked for the best superintendent I've ever had in my life was Dr. Lane Rickard. And she's retired now, but she was over there at Bacon County Schools. And she's the one that gave me the news that she couldn't renew my contract. But I got nothing respect for that lady and her husband. They are good people, and she's the best one. And she was the most brutal, honest person. So it's not women. It's not all about that right there. I love that lady. Still do to this day. And got nothing but respect for her and her husband. But that one at Dodge, I'll just leave it at that. I won't say anything further on that. But,
so you get over to Alabama to segue into that. And my boy David Thrower tells me that you go somewhere that ain't won since Hitler was a corporal.
Yeah.
Well, and you say it's old school. It's like the old days. Now, the only thing I know about small places in Alabama is every little town in Alabama has a high school.
Yes, sir.
And they all got a team.
Yes, sir.
So that's pretty cool.
That's why, we're in 3A over here, okay, and at Weaver. Now, that's not the first school. I'll backtrack here in just a minute. But I'm at Weaver now. This is my second year. We're a 3A school, and we have, in grades 9 through 12, 226 kids. So you got to realize that population-wise, Alabama here is totally different than in Georgia, population-wise. So it's a different measurement, okay? Totally different measurement here. Now, when I came here, I got a job. Old Jeffrey Bryant coached down in South Georgia a little bit too, but he's a Heflin boy. He was the principal at Cleburne County High School, which is Heflin, where I live. And he knew my wife, went to school with her, and he got me hired on here. Well, things didn't change in his hometown, so he is now the principal at Bowden High School. And you know how well Bowden's doing with Rich and all those guys. And Finley couldn't have it any better than having Jeffrey Bryan as a principal now. So I got hired on here. It took me about 3 months when I retired from Georgia to realize, hey, man, I still have that hunger to be a head coach and run things the way that I want to. And there was a couple of opportunities, but they were too far away. And then when the Weaver thing happened, which is right, I am probably 10 minutes above Oxford in Calhoun County Schools. And when I tell you I have another school called Sachs High School that is 2-3 minutes down the road, I mean 2-3 minutes. You know, usually got those big high schools in Gwinnett that may be that close together, but they have a population over 2,000 in each school. We don't. We got about the same number. We got about 10. They're not combining schools, man.
Right.
It's different over here. But, it's old school, and that's the way I like it. You know, and everybody in the county comes to football games, and if you're a Weaver person, shoot, man, you coming. But it's different at Weaver now. We got a 140-person band. Now, you heard what I said, 226 kids, 9 through 12. Now, we got 7th and 8th grade with us, too. But 9 through 12, like they measure it in high school, school population-wise, there's 226, and 140 of those from 7th grade 7 through 12 are in the band. So when we have a pep rally, you're either on the football team, you're either a cheerleader, or you're in the band. And we got about, 40 kids that may be up in the stands that are non-athletes. So you got volleyball there, too, in that little small school, and they do a great job with volleyball, softball players, and, you know, other athletes. But you're either an athlete, you're in the band, cheerleader, or you're a nothing, and they ain't too many nothings at Weaver High School.
Everybody's doing something.
Everybody's doing something. Yes, sir. But yeah, I do appreciate DT saying that. And let me backtrack a little bit right here too. Is this year, man, 0-5. I've never been 0-3. And it's a blessing to say that. I've never been 0-3, and we were 0-5. And Alabama people over here will know what Mount Chi-High is. I was about to take my truck and drive it off Mount Chi-High. I felt like it a few times after Friday night football games. And then, you know, hey, let me talk a little bit about the good Lord one more time right here. I just, you know, I have an issue about not giving God and trying to fix everything myself. And finally said, you know what, I'm going to go out here and I'll find my love for this stuff. I'm going to treat these kids right. And we're going to go back to basics. And we win two big ball games in a row, almost take out number 2 in the state, got beat by 5, had the lead at halftime, but got beat by 5 to number 2 team in the state. And then we win 1 with no time left on the clock, game 9. And then we beat the number 3 seed to take the number 3 seed in the region in the last game. And we just beat up in the first round of the playoffs last week. And I know Georgia got kind of pushed back a week, but this past Friday was our first round game. And a little school up in North Alabama called Sylvania got a good program. They beat us Friday. And but, you know, first time that 6 years that Weaver's made the playoffs, proud of that. But I really thought we'd be better, put on a better showing in the first part of the year than we did.
Well, how much is the atmosphere of high school football, has it changed since 96 when you got in it with NIL deals and people moving and recruiting and this guy's over here and this guy moves over here and, you know, just the way it's just changed so much, especially in the state of Georgia. Now that you have the perspective of being in two different states as a head coach.
Well, it's not, I'm going to tell you this, when NIL is not over here yet, thank the Lord. I can only imagine in Georgia. I've already heard stories from Carrollton High School over here, and I won't get into that too much, but look, I got into this game for small towns. I never wanted to be at a big school. Because I just dreamed of being a head coach at a small school, and that's all you did on Friday nights, and you played for where you played rec ball, and there was loyalty, and there was discipline, and you those coaches, you know, made better men, and I still think that's what it's about. I am an old head. I am old school. I will continue to believe that's the way that it should be. Is that the way that it is? No, and in Alabama in some places, it's not. Even some of your rural schools right here, in real rural in Alabama, you know, they move their kids to different schools because they don't think they have a shot. And half of these kids, let's just be honest, some of them ain't never going to play college football. Okay. Nor do they have the bodies, nor do they have the discipline to do it. And half the kids that were arguing about that come home in the first quarter playing college football because they're not. Mommy and daddy has babied their behinds the whole time, and mommy and daddy ain't going to be there for you the rest of your life. So, you know, we got to do our job, and those adults that are helping them kind of do that crap, I got nothing for them either. You're not producing tough young men. We want to know why the world has, you know, the wussification of America, as I call it, has become that way. That's why. We're getting too dang soft. And if we don't like the way things are going, well, let me just move my tail over here. And I can't stand it. But when NIL comes over here to Alabama, brother, I ain't so sure it ain't time for me to go sit in the recliner and watch TV all day long.
Well, I tell you something, Coach. It's not so much the NIL of, you know, paying high school kids for their name, image, and likeness. It's these kids that are highly recruited to go play at the next level that have an NIL deal, and they start making business decisions their senior year.
Yes.
And they look at you and go, well, I'm going to go on and shut it down for the rest of the year. Cause all I got to do was show up on campus in the fall in one piece, or in January in one piece.
Yep.
And I'm going to sign a check.
Yep. Well,
and that's something that's happening too.
It is. And let me tell you, it's probably happening to a lot of those coaches right there. And I'm not talking about anybody in particular, cause I 100% don't know, you know, who's having to deal with that. I really don't. But I can tell you who's not going to deal with it. And, you know, you can take your raggedy behind to some other school and I'll be fine, you know, coaching old Jim Bob Cooter that weighs 150 pounds and 5'6". I really don't care.
Right.
Now, I want to win just as much as anybody else does. I can't stand losing. I'm in a sourpuss mood every weekend if we get beat. Or, shoot, it's bad when we just don't put on a good show and then we win. You know, I take it that serious right there. But I am not going to lower the standards of what we're supposed to be producing. Nobody's ever going to say that Weaver High School does not put out tough kids that got disciplined. And I don't care if it's the star of the show. You know, our quarterback is something else, and he's a senior this year. And I love that kid to death. But if it takes getting on his tail, we do it. And he doesn't get treated any different than anybody else. But his butt works hard. That's my argument. I don't have to get on him as much because his tail works hard. And when he screws up, he fixes it, or he can't stand it himself. That's who I want to be around. You know, not that baby kid that's, you know, not going to make anything out of himself because he's been told how great he is. And then nobody gets on his tail to correct him.
Well, you're not going to win with those kind of kids in the long run anyway.
Man, I don't want to look. I can't share a field with somebody like that. I want to coach against a kid like that. Now, look, he may out athlete ours, but I want to coach against kids like that, because to me, we're going to build a bond on our team. We're going to build a family on our team, and I will win and lose with dudes like that. Well, I can win with that all day long.
Coach, you've won all day with kids like that over the years. It has been hard as crap to coach against you. It's been fun to watch you do what you do. Definitely one of the good guys in the business. Was so proud that you were able to go out on your terms and that you're still able to do it the way you want to do it, and that you're still giving back. And I appreciate you doing what you do and continuing to mold and shape young men.
Thank you, bud. I appreciate that. That's a hell of a comment right there, and a positive comment. And I appreciate it more than you know.
Well, Coach, I sure do appreciate you being on with us. And if there's anything I can ever do for you, you know, just let me know.
Yes, sir, buddy. Yes, sir. Appreciate you having me on.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.